So, hello.
Hello.
I'm very excited about doing this Bible study today, and we have a lot of different activities. So I would like to start out with a word search. And Aaron, so you have a copy of this word search already, so that's what we're going to start out with. And as soon as you get it, just see what words pop out at you. Go ahead and circle them. And we'll take about 3 minutes to do this. And then we'll come back together. Now these words can go horizontal, vertical, or diagonal. You'll see there are two questions down on the bottom, so you can keep that in mind as you're going. To what theme do these words pertain? Is there something they have in common? And what is the theme scripture? If you might know the book, chapter, and verse. As a little incentive, there are some prizes involved also. Okay, I'll give you about 20 more seconds. So as far as the scripture, that's just off the top of your head, not anything to look up.
Oh.
Okay, yeah. All right, so let's stop. And how many words did you find? And you can just put them on, you know, just put the number on the side of your page. Hey, you still finding words? Come on now, come on now. This is a Christian school. Yeah, how many did you find? 9? Okay. Anyone else?
11.
11? Anyone else?
30.
30?
Wow.
Wow.
Genius.
No. Okay. Thank you, Charles. Now I'll give you the word list, because I bet Charles found some words that weren't on the list. I don't know if there's 30 there. So based on the list, how many did you find?
How many did you find?
That's funny. That's like playing hangman when you can just get a word and make up a whole bunch of words. So look at the word list and check off what you found, and then give me the count. Okay, Charles, how many?
13.
13, okay. And anyone else?
Not the same.
Same, okay, excellent. Anybody find more than 13?
23.
23, okay, give me a high five for that. All right. Anyone find anything a lot higher than 23? Is 23 our winner? Okay, who found 23? So, here's a pen. I think you can always use a pen. So now, who found the least number? How many did you find?
Still 9.
9? How about you, Nee?
11.
Oh, you're not supposed to still be working. No, you found 9. All right, so I remember something about the order changing, that, you know, in the end, the first will be last. All right, last will be first, so we also have a prize for the person who found the least number. Okay, how about a theme? Any theme emerge? What did you come up with?
Fruit of the Spirit.
Fruit of the Spirit, okay. Excellent. Anybody, any scripture come to mind?
Galatians 5. Something.
22-ish.
Near the end, right?
22 to 24. Okay. I think that gets a pen also. I like that. Excellent. Thank you. So we have a couple of video clips, and as we move on, what I'd like to do is just give you a page to take some notes. And, you know, the notes can be whatever sort of jumps out at you. And I promise that by the time we finished our exercises today, it will all sort of hang together and make sense. Here you go.
Great. Did she say what age group this is?
Adults.
Adults.
All right, so let's see.
Understand how we have a tendency to look at gifts compared to how God looks at gifts. And how
I'm going to start that again. I think we may miss
you tonight about the difference in the gifts and the fruit. I want to talk to you about character development, because I think we have to understand how we have a tendency to look at gifts compared to how God looks at gifts, and how we need to realize that gifts are something that God gives us. We don't do anything to earn them. We don't really have to do anything to develop them. I mean, yes, we need to work with them. We need to learn how to use our gifts. But gifts are given. Fruit, however, is not given. It's developed. It's given to us in seed form when Christ comes to live in us. But the only way that we develop the fruit of the Spirit is through being put in situations where we need to use them and then using them. And it's like a muscle that's inactive. It'll become weak and wimpy, but when you begin to use that muscle, every time you use it, it gets a little bit stronger, a little bit stronger, a little bit stronger, and a little bit stronger. You pray for patience, and what you're going to get is a trial. I might as well tell you the truth before we get into this. If you start praying for the fruit of the Spirit to be developed in your life, you are going to get some people that are hard to get along with. You're going to meet some situations that are going to be hard on your temperament, but you need to be bold enough and brave enough to say, God, whatever I got to go through to get to where you want me to be, I want to go through it. I want to grow up. I want to be the person you want me to be, because here's what's going to happen if you don't. You're going to spend your whole life going around and around and around and around and around and around the same stupid mountains, up and down and up and down and up and down, feeling bad, wanting to do the right thing, doing the wrong thing, spending 3 days feeling guilty. We need to not be afraid to grow.
Okay, we can have the lights back. So, what would you say was the main point of that clip?
The difference between fruit and gifts.
Okay. And what is that difference?
Gifts are given and fruits are to be developed.
Absolutely. And how do fruits get developed?
I guess through doing it as you were doing it, I guess, which is experience.
Experience. And so when I first saw this clip, one of the things that stuck with me is that fruit is given in seed form. Mm-hmm. And who are those seeds from?
God.
Okay. Excellent. So we are going to move right along into one more exercise. And so I've got some little envelopes here, one for each of you. And you'll find some words in there. As soon as I give them to you, you can open them. And this is a scripture scramble. So there are some words in there. And when you put them together, it'll be a scripture that's quite familiar to you. So again, it'll take about 3 minutes to do that. So you can put those words in order. And I think you all have some great hints already as to what that scripture might be. Looks like we've got some Bible scholars in here.
I can't say that, but I know we're so
And if you think you have finished, raise your hand, and let me come and see. Are you finished?
I think I am.
Okay.
I think it's the last three or four of the order.
I don't know the order. I think I have an extra word. Are you missing a
the?
Yeah. Are you
missing a the? No, I'm actually
it might be right, right? I'm not sure.
Okay.
So, it's okay.
It doesn't count if it's not in order.
I'm mixing up the order. I know it's faithfulness and self-control at the end, but
you're going to tell us how it is in order. Gentleism. I don't know if I want to.
I think it's kindness.
It's self-control is last, for sure.
Yeah. Faithfulness and self-control.
Faithfulness and self-control.
And I'm pretty sure gentleness.
Is last.
Yeah. I'm pretty sure gentleness comes before faithfulness.
I know, but I don't know it.
I don't know.
Okay, we got two winners so far. Anybody else?
I don't know what it's
called. Anybody else?
I don't know what it's exactly.
Amazon gift card. $5. Those are good ideas.
Yeah,
those would be universally accepted.
Okay, well, here's what we'll do. We'll go over it. So somebody who's already gotten it, I'm sure this. Go ahead and read this for us, please.
But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, forbearance, goodness, kindness, gentleness, fruitfulness, and self-control. Against such things there is no law.
Amen. Amen. Okay. So I think everybody here is a winner.
Thank you.
Excellent. Excellent. Okay. Did you already win?
No.
No? Okay. How about you? Okay. Okay. Perfect. So, this is our theme scripture. Can we read it once together, please?
But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, forbearance, goodness, kindness, gentleness, faithfulness, and self-control.
Okay, amen. So one of the things as I was committing this to memory that helped me is the first three all have one syllable. The second three all have two syllables. And the third three have three syllables.
That's good.
Okay. Okay, so we have another quick video that we'll take a look at.
We have grown up learning how to process life through the negativity of the world around us. That means we've learned largely to react against people rather than respond for them. We've grown up in a culture that has provoked a mindset and a language that is adversarial, more bent upon defending ourselves against people rather than becoming a blessing to them. The kingdom of heaven allows us to move in the opposite spirit. And the fruit of the Spirit is the most powerful way of developing great relationships with people and also becoming Christ-like at the same time. So it doesn't really matter if a relational issue is adversarial, oppositional, or just difficult, or there are things going on that are causing misunderstanding and so on. None of those things matter. What matters is how we actually come across to people within the nature of God. That's what this message is really about. The fact that God has put a fruit of the Spirit next to every negative circumstance of life. So that we can say there is no negative situation that does not contain a fruit of the Spirit attached to it. So God allocates his nature to us in every circumstance of life. This is a groundbreaking tool for us to use in the development of relationships, and it's actually a game changer. I think it's one of the best game-changing experiences of life in Jesus. We get to be Christ-like to somebody, and we get to be changed in the nature of God in the same moment. Once you've heard this message, you will understand the keys that God is giving you to practice the development of great relationships no matter what is going on. It's that good.
Okay. So, what did you take away as the main point of this video?
I don't know if he was talking about that right there, but even if he was, this is an amazing tool. I never thought about it as a tool. I think he's talking about, but this is a tool that we can use to learn to be more like Christ. I never thought of it as a tool.
Absolutely. Anyone else?
I guess the fruit of the Spirit enables us, to treat each other the way God wants us to.
Absolutely. So treating each other, using it as a tool, is there a word that comes together that may sum this up in one word? It's something that we have with Christ. It's something we have with the Holy Trinity.
Relationships.
Absolutely. Okay, so, alrighty, we are moving right along. So, what would you say is the ministry of the Holy Spirit?
To teach?
Helps us, basically conform us in the image of Christ.
To conform us in the image of God, absolutely. Mm-hmm. And so, now, how would you put together what we've covered so far with that statement?
He's going to bring some trials.
Yes. Absolutely. Get ready. Anything else?
I was trying to connect it with the great commandment. Mm-hmm. To love God and love your neighbor.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Mm-hmm. And to this, I would just add that, or summarize that, the Holy Spirit's ministry of producing Christ-like characteristics in us is embodied in the fruit of the Spirit. Mm-hmm. Who or what do these words describe? When you hear the fruit of the Spirit, who or what does that describe?
God, Jesus.
God, Christ, Jesus. Mm-hmm. Absolutely. So clearly a constellation of qualities such as these are an accurate description of Jesus Christ. And insofar as being Christian means being Christ-like. So it stands to reason that we would want to develop and internalize such characteristics ourselves in order to be more Christ-like. How do you feel when you hear this list of words?
It's a lot.
So, does this list of qualities remind you of what's missing in your life? Does the lack of love in your heart towards certain people cause you some concern? Are you at times saddened by the absence of inner joy or inner peace? Does your own level of patience, kindness, and or goodness fall short of the demands of particular situations at times? Are you sorrowful over your own small level of faithfulness and gentleness in moments? And are you troubled by your own deficiency of self-control in some areas in your life? Raise your hand if you answered yes to any of these questions. Okay. Well, sisters and brothers, do not be discouraged and don't despair. All this means is that you are not Jesus. And I'm sure you already knew that when you got out of bed this morning. So there's good news.
Amen.
So before we go forward, I'd like to go a little further by saying by asking, what can you tell me about the context in which Paul's letter to the church of Galatia was written? What frame of mind do you think he might have been in? Our scripture today is taken from the letter to Galatia.
I guess he was concerned about their behavior. You know, so I guess, yeah.
Absolutely.
How they were treating each other.
How they were treating each other. What kind of fruit they were bearing. Mm-hmm. Okay. So he wrote this letter in great anger and distress of heart, because the believers were falling away from the simple message of the gospel. They were abandoning the message that a sinner is declared righteous before God as a free gift of his grace through faith in the cross. What did they believe instead?
The law. By works, what do you do?
Absolutely. They were falling for the lie that they could make themselves righteous before God through obedience to Old Testament law. Who was lying to them and misleading them?
I guess those from the temple, the Pharisees over there.
False teachers had been misleading the believers into thinking they could be made more righteous and acceptable on the basis of the law. So what would you say the fruit of the Spirit is all about?
Life effect of God on us. Mm-hmm. On our attitudes and our reactions.
This is what makes you really righteous, and not the law.
This is what makes you righteous, absolutely. So living by faith in the Son of God who indwells us is what the fruit of the Spirit is all about. What does this passage teach us?
That we should develop characters on the fruit of the Spirit, more Christ-like.
Absolutely. And can we develop those things on our own?
No,
we cannot. So the passage teaches us about the Holy Spirit's ministry of producing the perfect characteristic qualities of Jesus in us. So, two questions. The first is, an overall question, how the fruit, so this part isn't a question, so we'll talk a little about how the fruit of the Spirit is produced in us. But first I'd like to ask, are they called fruits, or is it called fruit?
It's fruit.
How many say fruit, singular?
Fruit.
I need a Greek lexicon. To be sure.
And how many say fruits, plural? It is called fruit, singular. Okay. So, now this next one's a trick question. How many fruits are there?
One.
So the fruit of the Spirit that is produced is not nine different fruits, but one singular fruit manifested in nine distinct qualities.
Oh my goodness. The law. One law. One fruit. Oh my
goodness. Oh! Amen! 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 The characteristic qualities of Jesus are not something that are produced by us, but they are produced in us. Mm-hmm. What is the process by which the Holy Spirit produces fruit in us? So to answer that, the Holy Spirit produces his fruit in us as a whole. It is not love this season, and joy the next fruit season, and peace the following season. What might happen if we were in charge of fruit production?
Oh. I would just tell me more.
You'd probably
to carbs and vegetables. And
we would get a schedule.
We get a schedule, okay. Okay. Anything
some
else?
Some of it would be produced and some of it not.
Okay.
I think we'll probably stick to the ones that we think we can do on our own. You know, stick to those and the ones that we think we can't do, you know, too hard, we like throw those
down.
Yeah. Absolutely. So if ever we're tempted or attempt to produce the fruit in our own lives under our own power, we might be inclined to pick and choose the qualities that we would want to produce. Even if we could manage to exhibit some characteristics that look like the fruit of the Spirit, it would not be the fruit of the Spirit at all. It would be artificial fruit. Kind of like wax fruit that is produced through our own efforts. Can you name any people in the Bible who were expert producers of faith fruit?
Pharisees.
They were great producers of wax fruit. And they were quite proud of the wax fruit they produced. And like the Pharisees, many today seek to exhibit those qualities of fruit of the Spirit that appeal to them. But they attempt to do this apart from Jesus and instead rely on their own efforts. Human effort cannot produce the fruit of the Holy Spirit. Finally, what else do we know about how fruit is produced? Remember the nature of fruit itself. So what do you know about fruit?
Takes time to develop.
Takes time to develop.
Starts with a seed.
Starts with a seed.
Now, be planted, yeah.
Needs to be planted.
Has to be connected to the vine.
Has to be connected to the vine, to the source, absolutely.
It's very tasty.
It's very tasty, absolutely. Tastes good.
Yeah.
Is what?
Unselfish
is
for others, not for trees.
It's not for the trees. It's developed and it's given away. It's for the benefit of others, for the nourishment of others.
That's good.
Good one.
You mean it's not supposed to stay on the tree and just go rot out?
No. If you stand under the tree, the fruit will fall on your head.
That's profound.
So fruit doesn't grow overnight, it grows over time through a process that is under the sovereign control of God.
Amen.
We must allow the Holy Spirit all the time He wishes in directing the timing and the process of the production of His own fruit in us. And we must accept that He brings us into various trials and tests that develop and perfect that fruit in us and not try to shortchange or short circuit the process. Is the list of qualities of the fruit of the Spirit random, or do you think that there's a logic to it?
I don't think God does anything randomly, so it has to be a logic behind it. It has to be a reason for it.
Okay. Now, I struggle with this a little bit because after taking Old Testament and New Testament and going through who actually wrote the Bible and how the Bible came into existence, it's not necessarily presented like the Ten Commandments, okay? So they're given out in an order. But if we do believe that the Bible is divinely inspired, then yes, there's an order. So. Any order come to mind for you?
Order? The first one is love.
Absolutely. First one is love.
Mm-hmm. Well, being that love is the first one, you can't develop any of these unless you have love.
Correct.
So they all have to follow up, and as they fall, there's falling in a sequence.
Right. Yep.
In the sequence.
Because love produces joy and peace. All those that comes after.
Mm-hmm. Okay, well, let me blow your mind. And I can't claim credit for this, but I can tell you the person that I found who revealed this to me. I don't have the name written down. The first three qualities can be said to do with the impact of our relationship with God through Christ. Love, joy, peace.
Okay.
The second qualities can be said to do with our relationship and interactions with others. Patience, kindness, and goodness. And the third three qualities can be said to do with our own inner state of being, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control.
Can you say that again, please?
Yeah. Absolutely. Nice. So the first three are said to impact our relationship with God through Jesus Christ. Love, joy, peace. The second three can be said to do with our relationship with others. Mm-hmm. Patience, kindness, goodness. And the final three said to do with our own inner state of being, essentially our relationship with ourselves, in a manner of speaking, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. So considered in these terms, the fruit of the Holy Spirit produces in all, the fruit that the Holy Spirit produces in all of us impact every relationship that we could ever have. With God, with others, with ourselves. So remember, so what are the two main commandments? Okay, so what? Love God. Mm-hmm. Love, joy, peace. Mm-hmm. Love your neighbor. Patience, kindness, goodness. Mm-hmm. As yourself. Mm-hmm. Faithfulness, gentleness, mm-hmm. and self-control. Mm-hmm. Finally, what does all of this tell us about righteousness? This is good news. Remember, you didn't wake up and look in the mirror and be Jesus, you're you. We no longer have to seek to be righteous before God on the basis of our performance in the law. Instead, we simply yield ourselves to the Holy Spirit and allow Him to produce His fruit in us. Against such, Paul says, there is no law. Amen?
Amen? Amen.
Okay. So now we're going to move on to the fun part. So now we have something called our scripture activity. And what I have here is, if you could just take one and pass it around and take one and pass it around. On the first handout, there are scriptures that have to do with spiritual fruit. And on the second handout, there are blanks. And what I'd like to do, you're coming. Oh, I gave you two? Yeah, okay. And so what I'd like you to do is work in teams of two. And I do. And if we had all day, we could do all of them. And Erin, you have these. These are the scriptures and the blanks. And we don't have all day, so as you work in groups of two, what I would like you to do is let me give you the instructions, and then what I'm going to do is I think I'm going to just assign each pair two scriptures so that when we come back together as a group, we can hear something from each scripture instead of if everybody starts at the top, we won't have anything from the bottom. So what I'd like to ask you to do is to read the scripture. And the first column says, what does this scripture say about spiritual fruit? The second column says, what is the fruit-producing principle that is identified? The third column is personal. The third column is once you've read what the scripture is saying about fruit and what the fruit-producing principle is, how is God ministering to you? What is the Holy Spirit saying to you when you answer the question, what actions are expected of me? Okay? So I'd like to ask this group to do the first two scriptures from Matthew. I'd like to ask this group to do the next two, one from Matthew, one from John. Like to ask this group to do one from John and going on to the next page, one from Romans. Like to ask this group to do Ephesians and Philippians. And I like to ask this group to do Colossians and Hebrews. Okay? And Aaron, if you don't mind, okay, we're gonna bring you over here to this group. Okay? And so we'll take a few minutes, and we will get to James because I've already done James. So all of the scriptures are in
so
front of you.
Is.
You don't have to look anything up. That's all pages. Yeah. All right?
Fruit grows if the seed falls on good soil. Right.
And that's the first to a person.
Yeah. Yeah. That's the first one.
And that's it refers to a person. Someone.
Yeah.
So,
yeah, good soil. And I think that means someone's, you know, heart, right? So, in other words, the fruit won't grow unless it falls in a good soil heart. Yep. What is the fruit-producing principle identified?
Actually, that was the principle, right?
I think that is the principle. Maybe it's, which is good soil yields fruit. So the condition of the soil. I am the true vine, my father is the gardener. Oh, the actions right there.
Well, so the first problem is when you read the scripture, what is it saying about fruit? What is it just sort of objectively, what does it tell you about fruit? So
I'm the true vine, my father is the gardener.
How is it produced? Okay. So your first is like, what is it describing about fruit?
Cuts off
and
every branch
that
bears no fruit.
How does
well,
it
every
get
branch
produced?
That does bear fruit, he prunes. Okay.
And then the
so
third
father
is
the gardener.
What does that mean to you?
That's true.
You've ever had fruit trees? We have some trees in Africa.
And
so much
sun. Jesus is the vine.
The more time we spend with Jesus, the more fruit.
My father does two things, right? Cuts or prunes. Cuts off.
Is what reduces the light. Like now, the spring is coming, and it's only going to take a couple of sunny days. Everything's going to go from brown to green. Because the light of the
dawn.
So
I like that spiritual photosynthesis.
Yeah,
it's like
great.
Coming alive again. We need it right now, the light. I like that too, because sometimes circumstances kind of like take the joy out of you. But when you come back to spending time with Jesus, you can almost, it's like that light again in your heart, you know, like spiritual light.
Okay, I'm going to just write in here for the
So what aspect of us to ask the dead if we're going to bear more fruit, we really need to be able to ask the name of Father.
That's what I'm saying. That's what I'm saying. When it comes to patience.
All I can say is when you do ask it, you're ready to get
it. I know, that's the thing.
And if the branch doesn't have fruit, it doesn't really belong to
Jesus.
And the Father will push it. We should focus on the positive side, of course, which is he'll prune it and make more fruit for the already fruit-bearing branch.
It's an exhortation.
And it's just the whole thing here is principle about say, the relationship is, of us to the vine.
If you don't lose it,
you're more so than the fruit. The fruit is the result of that relationship. Yeah. Focus on this. I am the vine. You're the tree. Remain in the water bear. Apart from you,
it's a song.
Yeah. Sign or indicator.
You know what I mean? So
I know what you mean by that, because sometimes a sign is used to refer to Jesus' identity, right? And then interesting, like Dan is there, is if you remain in me and my words remain in you, ask whatever you wish and it'll be done for you. So before they were talking about fruitfulness or lack of fruitfulness. And now they're saying, if you are in me and fruitful,
basically, you will know them by their fruit, by their attitude, by their
behavior.
It is. You want to know what fruit they eat, if their powers are not God.
Yeah.
Is what
like
we do. If you can say what a fruit is, or actions,
I don't want to say outer terms, but right, interesting compared to the rest of the verses.
So then, so that's what it
is. Ask whatever you wish.
Yes, we'll be done.
The wisdom and understanding that the spirit gives.
Right. Is your mind in me? It's his words, right? And not my words. I mean, it's in myself.
Okay, hopefully by now you're at least on your second scripture and wrapping up.
I would try and do something. I thought I needed to be productive in that time, but I realized that I really need to take that time to quiet my soul and rest myself. And something that Sharon Thornton actually said to me is, it's really great to have my Bible out all day long, laying somewhere where I can glance at that scripture. And she said, that is something my children will see. They'll see, oh, mommy was reading the Bible all day long. Mommy was praying all day long. And they can, you know, they'll learn from that. And that was really encouraging to me that it didn't have to be 30 minutes sitting down and reading my Bible and nothing else.
Right. Idealistic, isn't that? And it's the Father that either increases or removes.
Okay, a few more moments and let's wrap up. We'll come together as a group.
What actions are expected of me? Abide. Remain.
Bring it back to me, you know. Bring a breath.
Remain, again, remain, abide, over and over, right? And interestingly, when he says remain in me, that sounds nice, but how? Verse 7. If you remain in me and my words remain in you. So, abiding in him is heavily dependent on the word of God dwelling in us.
Okay, let's come back together, please. And in the interest of time, what I'd like to do is ask each pair to select one scripture to share. And you may read the scripture, identify what this, what you as a, have come up with as what the scripture is saying about spiritual fruit, what the fruit-producing principle that is identified is, and each person, I think we have time for each person to identify, if they so choose, what actions are expected of God, expected by God of them, okay? So let's start with Matthew 3, 8 to 10. I'm sorry, let's start with this pair. Choose which scripture you would like to share. Okay.
You want us to read the scripture?
I'll read the scripture. Okay. We can discern false prophets by the fruit they bear. Oh, I'm not reading the scripture. I'm reading my answer. I'm sorry. I'm glad this isn't a closed book test, so I need to have my glasses. faces. The expressions on your faces were priceless. That's the new Maria Elena Grosset version of the Bible. Matthew 7:15-20. Watch out for false prophets. They come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they are ferocious wolves. By their fruit you will recognize them. Do people pick grapes from the bushes or figs from thistles? Likewise, every good tree bears good fruit, but a bad tree bears bad fruit. A good tree cannot bear bad fruit, and a bad tree cannot bear good fruit. Every tree that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. Thus, by their fruit, you will recognize them. Okay, so what did you come up with?
Our first is what we think the scripture is saying about the spiritual fruit is that your fruit will be recognizable of who you are. So your fruit will be in time revealed. So if you're bad fruit, it's going to get revelation. So you can't hide your fruit. It's going to get being known. So that's our, what the scripture says.
Okay. Fruit producing principle?
I think for that one, I think it raises the question in this passage, like, what does it mean to be a good tree? Because basically, it seems like a good tree produces good fruit. So we have to ask, what does it mean to be a good tree? Because ultimately, the task is, may we be good trees that we might produce good fruit? So, I think the principle that we're looking at is being a good tree that you might produce good fruit. And so I think maybe possibly we start trying to tie some other scriptures to it. And so we're thinking, like, a good tree is a tree that's planted by the seed of the Holy Spirit himself.
Okay, and again, I'm being mindful of time, so we'll leave the third column for each individual. So we're going to just go through the first two. One of the things that, absolutely. Okay, so for this pair, which scripture?
The other one is more. John 15:1-8.
Okay. So we're not going to read that one. I'm going to glance at it.
Yes.
And why don't you go ahead to what does the scripture say about fruit and what is the fruit producing principle?
You said you did the first one. The scripture say about scripture.
Yeah, so in the scripture, it's talking about this is when it's talking about on the vine, you're the branches. If you remain in me, that's what the scripture is about. And about spiritual fruit, I have a couple things. But the Father's a gardener, he cuts and prunes. Jesus is the vine, and it's for his glory.
Mm-hmm.
There's a couple more things in there, it's a lot in there.
And the fruit-producing principle, I think, is it's the relationship that produces fruit, the intimacy with Christ that is the only way to produce fruit. And interestingly, I think it's more specific than just feeling close to him, which is important. It says in verse 4, remain in me as I also remain in you. Verse 7 says, parallel, but a little different. If you remain in me, and my words remain in you.
Mm-hmm.
So hearing the word of God is abiding in Jesus.
Mm-hmm. So it's relationship and
through,
connection.
Through the word.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
This pair?
John 15:16.
Okay. And what does it say about
fruit? It says that we're chosen and appointed to bear fruit. And the principle will be fruit that will last.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And to add to that, one of the other things I came up with also was that what I ask in the name of Jesus will be given.
Oh, we had actually put that as what is expected of
you. Now that's so funny because I had it exactly flipped. So, okay, there's no wrong answer. I had as the principle what I ask, and I had as my action that I am expected to bear fruit that will last. So we can't go wrong. Excellent. This pair.
You've got Hebrews 12:11-13.
Okay, and the what does it say about?
It says that fruit bearing involves discipline, and it's not always pleasant. Mm-hmm. I think it's painful.
Mm-hmm.
And the principle?
See, I kind of confused like what the difference was, but this
go
one,
for it.
Yeah, that's what I wrote down. It's like, fruit is born through trial.
Come on.
Absolutely. Okay, and so now we're going to hear from Aaron. Now, this was not a pair, this was a trio. So, okay. Okay. And the, what does it say about fruit?
It says it comes from the light, and it produces light, and the fruit is goodness, righteousness, and truth.
Mm-hmm. Okay, and?
The principle is to live in the light and expose the darkness.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Amen. Okay, so let me just check my outline here. Okay, so we have another quick video, and you'll see you all are so good at this, you could be making the videos.
Every day, we face challenging circumstances that are accompanied by difficult decisions. We have the choice to respond by faith, or we can let doubt dictate our decision-making. And the response we choose determines the type of seed we sow, a seed of fear or a seed of faith. The seed we sow determines the fruit we produce, and the fruit produced reflects the person we are. When we react in our own strength, we plant unhealthy seeds that produce fruits of the sinful nature. Bitterness, misery, worry, and frustration. Harshness, evil, dishonesty, violence, and indulgence. These choices prevent us from becoming the person God created us to be and growing in our relationship with Him. When we choose to trust God, we plant seeds that open our hearts to be filled with the fruit of the Spirit. Love, joy, peace, patience, and kindness. Goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. We reflect the image of Christ to the world and experience the very nature of God in our lives. Though we do not have the power to produce this good fruit, we do have the choice to plant good seed. A seed of fear or a seed of faith? What seeds will you sow?
Respectful of our time because I know that Amy would like to spend a little time with us. So I would just like to tell you what else I had planned, but I'm just going to fast forward. So the next thing was a fruit tree discussion. And so what I sort of did was I brainstormed, and so the discussion would go like this. Tell me about a fruit tree.
And so I said, what does it have? What does it need? What threatens it? What protects it? And so I would lead the discussion, and you all would probably come up with everything that I already have here. But then as you say, you know, participate, I would just add whatever you may not have added. And again, for the interest of time, so what does it have? It has roots, it has a trunk, branches, leaves, fruit, seed, and bark. And so we would be able to sort of talk about that. What does it need? It needs soil. It needs the right soil. It needs rich soil. It needs sun. It needs water. It needs rain. What threatens it? Weather, frost, low temperature, drought, flood, scorching, high temperatures, animals, insects, humans, location, disease, and rocks. And what protects it? Fences, people, God, its height, its location, and the volume of fruit. And so then the next question would be, in what ways and how are we as Christians like fruit trees? And so I imagine that as you listen to the words, there you know, metaphors and analogies certainly begin to jump out at you. Okay, so...
I only need five minutes at the end, so...
Okay, so I'm good. Okay, because I still have a little more. But you can see a discussion like that, we could go on for 45 minutes. Yeah. So I'll go forward with my next video. And so let me...
Today, I'm going to show you how to use Wayfair.
No, you're not. Okay. .com
to create a budget friend.
Okay. All right, so this concludes our Bible lesson. I have one more thing I would like to give out for you to take home with you, and it's called a spiritual fruit law. So this is something that you can take with you, and I'll go over. So in this spiritual fruit log at the top, what I'd like for you to do is take a moment, not right this minute, at some point today, to rate yourself on a scale of 0 to 10, 0 being low, 10 being high. Rate you what you think your overall level of development is in that area. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Now, this is very funny. Okay, so I created this for the Bible study I taught on a Saturday. So the first day is Sunday. So had I revised this, the first day would be Tuesday. But anyway, you can adapt it. So the first column says, list three or more if you wish, Christ-like characteristics that you were aware of utilizing or calling upon most on that day. So those are areas in which you are comfortable and consider yourself well developed. So then the right column is list three Christ-like characteristics, again, or more if you wish, or less, you were aware that were being produced in you that day. Areas in which you were being stretched and challenged. So do this for a week. At the end of that week, do the rating again. On a scale of 0 to 10, rate your overall development in that area. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Then I put two questions down for you to give thought to. What I learned this week about the fruit I bear in relation to what is expected of me by God according to His Word. And so those expectations go back to that scripture activity that we did, that third column, the shaded column. As you read each scripture, you talk, you meditate on what it's saying about fruit. You listed what the fruit producing principle is, and then you wrote down what does God expect of you. So based on that, what did you learn about yourself in the week? And then finally, set a goal. What is my goal next week in terms of my fruitfulness based on what God is expecting of me? And the very bottom says, use the back sheet of this paper to write about any changes in rating in overall levels of development this week. So that means compare the top to the bottom and see where the numbers have changed. And guess what? Some of the numbers may have gone down, and that's okay too. But this just really is intended to raise your consciousness and to just give you some more to talk to God about. Thank you.